Great. Well, good morning and welcome as people start to join into today's webinar. On behalf of Concordia, welcome. And it's good to see some waves across and thumbs up from the audience. And so nice to see friends reconnecting. We're very pleased here at Concordia to be hosting today's conversation with our inspiring 2019 program partner Sesame Workshop. And for this important discussion on our littlest people and how early age education and support interventions can result in a lifetime of resiliency. We will get started right away, right now, in the interest of time, in the interest of ensuring there's time for questions at the tail end as well. There's a lot to get through today. Before we get started and turn to Dr. Betancourt and Adolf Falcon, I want to take a moment to ground this discussion in Concordia's mission of strengthening and supporting the partnering ecosystem. By way of introduction, my name is Hannah Dalmit. I'm the Senior Director of Partnership Development. And we believe here at Concordia that now is a critical time for cross-sector collaboration, public-private partnerships, and a unified world. And that's why Concordia is reaffirming its unwavering commitment to maintaining its position as the leading nonpartisan convener alongside the UN General Assembly. And while the unprecedented nature of the virus is calling for a temporary increase in physical distance, it doesn't mean we can't still come together. This virtual discussion on the role of partnerships on the front lines of the global response to the pandemic is designed for our member community, especially those building partnership-based interventions to support local, national, and global responses during this time. Throughout today's discussion and other webinars held in this series, we've been teasing out applied best practices and informing a forthcoming resource on designing accelerated partnerships. This is part of our commitment at Concordia to support the formation and structure of new local and global initiatives contributing to the response through impactful and transformational partnerships. I encourage you to connect directly with me during or after this call if Concordia can support you in this regard. We're also still looking to host the largest and most inclusive event alongside the UN General Assembly in New York this September, and we hope to have the opportunity to welcome you to this 10th annual summit. We're designing influential and substantial programming dedicated to global response to COVID-19's immediate devastation and aftermath, as well as tackling a range of issues that are driving policymakers and private sector and public sector actors together today. So if you're interested at all in the Concordia Annual Summit coming up, I encourage you to connect with our Director of Programming, Kevin Wenzel. And finally, we are a membership-based organization. So if you were invited to this program by Concordia, Sesame Workshop, or the National Alliance for Hispanic Health due to the relevancy of your work to this topic, welcome. It's so great to have you. I encourage you to consider Concordia membership and be part of this global partnership-based transformation year-round. Community lies at the heart of all we do. As we navigate this complex and tumultuous time together, we're focusing on what we do best, building strong networks, bridging partnerships for social impact, and fostering a community like yourselves to better the world. While it feels at times like life's been a bit on hold, at Concordia, we're doing everything we possibly can to strengthen our community and double down on our values of collaboration, partnership, and unity. Great. So I know we're all experts at Zoom, but we're gonna do a little bit of housekeeping just for those that are joining us for the first time. So welcome to Concordia Live. We're really happy to have you as part of today's important discussion and conversation. We're trying things a bit differently today than we have with past ones to help encourage conversation and networking both pre and post. So I've seen a few people introduce themselves in the chat feature. This is so wonderful. And it adds to the dynamism of our conversations. So you'll be muted and your video, you're welcome to keep it on or to turn it off during the bulk of the discussion, but we do wanna hear from you, we do wanna see you. And so for the Q&A, we do ask that you unmute when you're asking a question and turn on your video. We'll have a live Q&A at the very end of this discussion. You can either raise your hand to engage or unmute yourself or type directly into this chat feature as well. Concordia will be monitoring that chat feature, so if you have questions throughout the discussion, ideas, want to drill down onto something, again, this is part of keeping this a dynamic conversation. Further, in an effort to support networking and follow-on conversations, we'll be opening a breakout session for 15 minutes following the completion of discussion. And we welcome you to join us for as much as your schedule permits and share your work and reactions to others on this call. You'll automatically be placed into a breakout group, so nothing further is necessary on your side. And we hope you can join for as much as your schedule and interest permits. And finally, the majority of this webinar will be recorded and available on Concordia's webpage and YouTube channel. The Q&A portion and the post-event breakout discussions will not be recorded. This is a member benefit and only open to those that are joining us today. So with that in mind, it's my sincere pleasure to introduce our two speakers. We have Dr. Jeanette Betancourt, who's the Senior Vice President for U.S. Social Impact at Sesame Workshop, the nonprofit organization behind Sesame Street. She directs the development and implementation of community and family engagement initiatives, making a difference in the lives of vulnerable children and their families. And when asked, she responded like any parent would. She does not have a favorite Sesame character, loves them all equally. Adolf Falcon is the Executive Vice President of the National Alliance for Hispanic Health. He provides leadership and management for the Alliance's program, science, and policy portfolios, and runs POINT on the Alliance partnership with Sesame Workshop, dedicated to bringing bilingual resources to families and early childhood service providers to support children in their first years of life. He does have a favorite, it's Oscar the Grouch. So with that in mind, it's my sincere pleasure. We're gonna pass it over to Dr. Betancourt to kick off this conversation. We will be showing some videos as well, and then going directly into the discussion between Adolf and Jeanette. So Dr. Betancourt, if you want to unmute yourself.
Thank you so much, Hannah, and especially to Concordia to bring together so many people, but particularly to highlight the needs of children, especially young children globally. So first, let me introduce Sesame Workshop a little bit more. Sesame Workshop, as Hannah indicated, is the nonprofit organization behind Sesame Street and so much more. And it's a global organization in which we're in over 160 countries. And our main mission is to help all children grow smarter, stronger, and kinder. And for those that are more in the early childhood community, you understand that that is really what we say is the whole child, meaning that we are approaching everything around the child's overall needs. And also, we like to form what we call circles of care, the important adults around children's lives that influence them on an ongoing basis across many sectors. So the concept of partnerships is key to what we do. So we also have an incredible history of addressing not only the idea of nourishing children's overall well-being, both in their learning and their curiosity and their health well-being, but also addressing the greatest challenges that often face vulnerable children and the families. And when COVID-19 and this pandemic really occurred, we knew not only that we had to respond, but we had to respond in the way that we always do. So we determined a couple of factors. What is it that we should be doing? First, we knew that we had to continue to maintain that connection of comfort and connection with our wonderful Muppets across the world. And we did that. We started to really make available our Muppets in different ways, considering social or what we call physical distancing, and keeping that connection so that there's comfort. But we also determined that there were critical areas we needed to address. One was, how do we accelerate the idea of healthy practices from a child's perspective? How do we provide those preventive practices so that they become routine? And then the more important, and I think we'll start to be much more in depth in the discussion between Adolf and myself, is how do we continue to support the well-being or the emotional support of young children and their families in these circumstances of physical distancing, of shelter in place, and the lack of support services that are often so essential? So we took a very strategic approach on that. But before that, what I want to show you is how we use the power of our wonderful Muppets to guide some of this thinking and create and model practices around health prevention that, again, can be done so easily between adults and children. So I'm going to show you our Washy Wash video, which actually was versioned into 29 languages and created globally. I think we're missing a little audio on that one. Well, what I'm going to tell you is that although you can't hear this incredible audio that is there, the initiative is called Caring for Each Other, and everything is available on sesamestreet.org/caring. And what you would have heard was an incredible song that actually looks at 20 seconds of how to effectively wash your hands in a way that models both for adults and children.
Jeanette, apologies. I'd like me to play a little snippet of it so people can get a sense. Apologies for that.
That would be really nice because then everyone will be sesametized a little bit. Washy, wash, washy, wash, wash your hands. Scrub while you sing the song. Wash, washy, wash, washy, wash, wash. So thank you, Hannah. And if you noted several things there, we are sure that we're representing a global perspective. So when we're creating this content, it is not only freely available, but it is also available in a way that it can be used around the world and really delivering critical messages. Before we go into our discussion, I did want to then delve a little bit, which I believe will be our platform of what we will discuss, Adolf and myself, is how do we continue to provide emotional support on an ongoing basis? So one of the things that we did is we started to identify critical areas that were happening in children's lives, especially young children, and how essential it is to, again, deliver information from their perspective. So one of the things that we dealt with is how do you deal with sickness? And how do you deal with a person who is really a child who's in a situation where there's an ill parent? And so we had a video for that as well. Hannah?
Hi, it's me, Alan from Sesame Street. Today we're going to hear a story about my friend Buddy. Buddy's dad isn't feeling well. Right now he needs to get lots of rest, drink plenty of water, and be alone for a while. Now Buddy's dad gets his own room. Buddy imagines he has lots of space to stretch out in bed at night. And Buddy's mom sleeps on the couch or in the room with him. Buddy likes that she's so close. Sometimes Buddy feels overwhelmed with so many new changes.
Bobby, will you tell me our helping story?
She reminds him that by staying apart and washing their hands, they're helping each other stay healthy. She tells Buddy that it's okay to feel sad, frustrated, or even scared. Look, it's Buddy's dad. Buddy can still talk to him over the phone or through video chat, just like he does with his friends. Buddy feels good knowing that he's helping keep his family healthy and that they are all in it together. Visit sesamestreet.org/caring for more.
Thank you. So Hannah, that gives an example and to everyone of some of the foundational content that we're producing, but I'd love to engage in the discussion with Adolf because I do want to share the background and philosophy of the kind of emotional support that we're taking on a rolling basis, and more importantly, how it is through partnerships that we can all continue to form a circle of care around our children and families, especially those most vulnerable.
Well, thanks so much, Jeanette, and thanks everybody for joining this morning. In a time of physical distancing, and by the way, I love the change in term. I'm using it from here on out. But in these times, it's more important than ever that we all get a chance to hear from each other, and especially all of us who are services providers, to hear what's happening with other folks and to be a source of support for each other. And to you, Jeanette, and everybody at the Sesame Workshop, I have to really thank you for the thoughtfulness and the quality of the products that you all are producing and sending out to us so we can do our work. You know, and from the two snippets we saw, we can tell the quality and the thoughtfulness of the work. Could you talk a little bit about what are the underpinnings for how you all have developed the resources, and what are the foundational considerations for how you put together resources?
Well, first, obviously, it was the adjustment. Suddenly, we're all a very collective group that we enjoy this closeness of brainstorming and what are the immediate ideas that we need to come together. And suddenly, we were working virtually and with physical distancing. And what we realized from the very beginning is what we've done for 50 years is what we have to continue to do. So first was our knowledge around child development. How do you provide this information from a child's perspective, but what are the best practices that we should be doing? Second, how do we do this creatively and leverage our Muppets in ways that they can message and model these practices, but also recognize how, from a child's point of view, how adults can respond. So if you saw in the sickness video, we particularly started to talk about the concept of big feelings. And that is really a translation for young children and the adults around them on how they can talk about the various feelings that the children are having. Everything from being happy to being close to their parents or caregivers on an ongoing basis, to also the frustrations of missing their friends or not having regular routines. So we took what we know best in our practices that we do every day, and we immediately applied them in this area.
Now, for those of us who don't know the National Alliance for Hispanic Health, we are an organization of community-based organizations that provide services to 15 million underserved in communities every year. And it's a range of health and human services. And we have a supporting organization, the Healthy Americas Foundation, that does the work internationally. And we're very proud to be a partner of Sesame Workshop and developing resources. We've always been very proud that Sesame Workshop is a foundational practice, is always made available the materials in both English and Spanish and values, bilingualism and values culture as a foundational work. And in our work together, we were very happy that we started a partnership where we were able to produce materials and send them out to communities because it almost feels like we were ready for COVID-19 to have something available to help parents. And in a crisis like this, parents are looking for answers, they're looking for support. I'm just wondering, what have you heard from your many partners about what parents are saying and what parents are experiencing?
So a couple of things, Adolf. One, you pointed out the need for those partnerships, and we've had our partnership for many, many years. And as you said, we're both targeted on reaching those that are most vulnerable. So you mentioned our ability to produce resources bilingually. And in this case, we actually produced them in 29 languages. But when we look at that, we look at it already from the perception of families and parents and information that we were hearing. And that was, how do we model, how do we present these in a way that are easy and visible? And so for parents, what we often heard was a lot of confusion. Confusion from families saying, suddenly I'm either in a situation where we are all shelter in place, and my children are here and I am working or I'm involved with other practices that I have to continue, and how do I balance those daily routines? But also, how do I keep my children connected and entertained and curious, especially young children? On the other hand, there was also the tremendous concern, particularly for many of our communities in which many are essential workers or frontline workers. And how do I explain that when I come home, I cannot connect my child immediately like we normally do? So what we've done is we've actually taken all of that information, and we hear from our partners, we hear through social media as well, through all kinds of means. And what we've taken is an approach of emotional response into three stages. One, what we call the for now normal, meaning what is happening now as we're in shelter in place and physically distanced, and how do we respond to that? Then the second stage is the very different, but transition to the before normal. How do we help children ease back into some of the systems and practices? And then the third is that we're taking in what are the long-term effects on young children and families, especially those most vulnerable, around areas of long-term traumatic effects, whether it's food insecurity, financial instability, the social toll this is taking on children on everyday moments and the adults around them. They're generally the adults that are their core that are equally feeling that stress and anxiety. So we take all of that into account and continue with partners such as yourself to respond and also get your involvement as we're producing these resources.
Well, let's follow up on that. A sense of security is foundational to a healthy childhood. We all know that. And the impact of traumatic events and circumstances on undermining that sense of security for children has always been something that Sesame Street has cared about and has produced resources about and has focused on. Certainly you and I had the opportunity right after the horrific shootings in El Paso that were driven by a xenophobic killer. To be able to respond and in the community build Big Bird's comfy, cozy spaces. So kids had a safe place to go and to work out feelings, and which was tremendous. And COVID-19, again, is attacking that sense of security. Could you talk a little bit about just generally why Sesame Workshop has focused on that, on dealing with issues of trauma and childhood security, and maybe a little bit about what you see the role of the workshop going forward in the recovery from COVID-19.
Mm-hmm. A lot of what you're speaking about, Adolf, is under our what we call our program Sesame Street and Communities. And it is what it says, is how do we address the needs of communities, and particularly those that are most vulnerable. And what we started to discover when we're speaking about traumatic experiences is that they are often very adult issues. And those traumatic experiences, even before COVID-19, included topics that we addressed around parental addiction, family homelessness, foster care, a parent who's incarcerated. And the irony is that if we put numbers to that, there are millions and millions of children across our nation that are impacted by these issues. But often the voice of the young child is lost. So our goal is, how do we bring awareness about these issues? How do we also form that circle of care with our resources that are freely available on SesameStreet.org, SesameStreetCommunities.org? And how do we make those resources in a way that are integrated into different systems so that you can always use the resources to extend and present the child's perspective and address the needs of young children and bring awareness about that issue in your community. Our goal always is going back to what you said earlier, Adolf, it's that idea, how do we make these not only relevant in different provider systems, whether it's child welfare, whether it is healthcare, but it's also using this incredible connection and power of our brand. And as we were talking about our favorite Muppets and this concept of being sesametized, to bring comfort, to also bring a sense of hope and resilience for the future. Because even though these are extremely difficult topics, often what we lose is the moving forward, the resilience. And that's what we hope to accomplish with our resources, but more importantly, our strategies, because they're always built on a strength-based approach.
Well, thank you for that. And on behalf of the thousands of services providers in our network and the millions of parents in our network, I really have to thank Sesame Workshop, Sesame Street and Communities for the resources. I mean, our preschools have been using it for virtual classes. We just had a virtual health fair in Dallas. They use the resources, and we had parents actually take up the Washi Wash song They started their own social media challenge, encouraging other parents and kids to washy-wash. And I have to thank you. You know, institutions are the people in those institutions. And Sesame Workshop is who it is in part because of folks like you, and just a big thank you, particularly in these times.
Thank you, Adolf. And more importantly, it is partners such as yourself that allow us to reach the families and children that we need to reach, and in the creative ways that you're sharing with us. So thank you.
Well, now I'm going to blush. I'll turn it over.
Likewise.
I just love hearing two partner entities say such kind words about each other unprompted. And I think it's a testament to one of the strengths of what the Alliance and Sesame Workshop have been able to accomplish together, because they're both leveraging this partnership to truly accomplish their values and their goals. And they live and they embody these year round. And so this commitment to equality, to equity, to access, and to celebrating diversity throughout all of their learnings is perhaps one of the reasons why this partnership is such a strong match and for both entities. With that, I would love to, in a moment, turn to our Q&A. But prior to doing so, I just want to take a moment to formally thank Dr. Betancourt and Adolf for today's conversation, the work that they are doing. The Q&A session is reserved for our Concordia members, and so the recording will stop here. But that doesn't mean the discussion should. So with that, I would love to just turn over to some questions. Let's see, we have one from Christina Gilbert, who introduced herself earlier. She is the former head of a nonprofit in Missouri focused on early childhood development and with working with at-risk families. She writes, I know as a parent when all this started, Sesame Street and Daniel Tiger were what my kids needed right away. So thank you for this work. One thing that might be intergenerational would be something that connects that concept of mommy is fried, she needs a minute. It doesn't mean the child is any less loved or needed. And I know we have several moms on this chat right now, or parents nodding. So this is occurring across families. And so I just wanted to put that out there. She also expresses gratitude for the languages that all of this is being produced in, for that inclusivity element. I think that goes to a question, though. I mean, so much of the stress from COVID-19, whether it's health-related, economic-related, or just the lack of structure, that is permeating into the family unit, and kids are really starting to feel that. So I'm curious if you do have, I know we spoke a bit about it, but do you think that there will be more parent-oriented programming to help kids understand how they're part of this as well?
It's interesting what you saw were the videos, and we often think of them as only child-centered, but obviously they're both adult and child, but connected. And if you do go on Sesame Street in communities.org, you will see a whole cadre of resources. And there are sections also that are specifically for parents and caregivers. Again, highlighting not only the strategies that are modeled in the videos, but also ways of self-care. It is that idea that we indicate that unless you're taking care of yourself, making time for yourself, knowing that there will be just as much as up and downs that you see in your children, in yourself as well as an adult, and especially if you're continuing to work or you're an essential frontline worker. So the resources are there, and they're coupled so that they go hand in hand with our videos.
Excellent. And Concordia will be sending out an email after today's conversation with this video recording and a summary of the discussion. We'll also include links to those resources so that they're readily accessible to everybody who's joining.
Thank you.
If we don't have another question in the chat, I'll just take a moment and ask from a Concordia perspective, again, related to partnerships. The Sesame Workshop and the Hispanic Health Alliance partnership existed pre-COVID-19. Adolf referenced a bit that this came into fruition following the El Paso shooting and kind of the need for more attention around trauma resiliency and childhood security. So I'm curious how the fact that that partnership already existed, how it might have supported the growth or the advancement of the current work you're doing together today. Or if you think that, or if you have advice for any new partnerships that you might have started just in wake of COVID-19.
It is both. It's one of the things that we wanted to make sure, particularly in partnerships around COVID-19, is that they went beyond just either healthcare or education. So we've also have quite a bit of partnerships around our military and family and veteran work, our work around autism. So what we wanted to do is really create a cadre of partners to assure that these resources were available and embedded, but also hearing their needs. I think what you hear from our partnership between Adolf and myself, ourselves in terms of responding, is that we're continually connecting and communicating. So it isn't when something happens. It is that we are connected, we're seeking advice of one another that helps them to either prepare for future emergencies or demands or challenges, or continues to connect us on how we can, again, take advantage of one another's networks and really embed resources, strategies in a way that are consistent. And that's what I would say to any partnership. It is, how do you listen? How do you work together? And how do you prepare not only for the present, but also for the future?
And, you know, I have to emphasize the importance of listening. Really, Sesame Workshop is one of those partners who really is willing to listen and puts a priority on that. And that just creates better products, it creates better partnerships, and ultimately it creates better services that we're able to provide.
Wonderful. I think that is a fantastic encapsulation of a lesson learned or a best practice for partnerships. So thank you both for sharing that. We are on time. I'm conscious of everyone's schedule in this new normal. And so with that, I just want to thank again, Dr. Betancourt, Adolf Falcone, and the amazing teams behind them that enable the type of community resources out there that are so important during this time and other just the day-to-day. And so with that, we'll stop the formal webinar. We will go into breakout rooms. What's going to happen next is you'll be whisked into a space. If your schedule doesn't permit you to stay, that's completely fine. You can just end the session on your side. But it does allow for a little additional side conversation with a handful of participants today. And we hope this contributes to some of your network and your on-the-ground work. Thank you to everybody who's joined us today. Thank you to our speakers and to our teams. And with that, we are going to whisk away. Good luck.
Thank you.